Now let's see, 20 plus 10 is 30, and I divide it by 2, 15. So that's why, for example, if you average the neutron density, you're not that far from a cross plot. It gets a little spooky down here where it gets curved, but up in this range, it's not that bad. If somebody provides you with a cross plot porosity, you'll get these on ELISPRO, go with it, because it's going with the chart. But the average of neutron density is pretty good. And there they are. So our three examples, the Pennsylvania pneumotic limestone, there's the tight zones down there, the squares, and they're roughly on that line here. They're going to wobble around a little bit because, remember, the density of the neutron are radioactive tools and they're counting particles, so there's a little bit of jigger there, but nevertheless, pretty much on that line. The sandstone, well, they're bobbling around here. Some points are pulling in this direction, they're picking up the calcite cement, a little bit lift coming up here as we're picking up gas effect. And finally, that Towanda dolomite was all over the place. Those are the triangles on the dolomite line here, and some of them are pulling up here actually towards limestone and cherty material actually, and some of them dragging a little bit in that direction for the anhydrite. So we have quite a mixture of minerals going there. But that's great, because if you're working with a lithology that's got all sorts of stuff in it, then the cross plot will resolve it for you. It doesn't really matter how much mixture you have. And you can either resolve it from the cross plot or you can take the average. Because look at this triangle here, you say, well, I don't know. It could be a cherty dolomite. It could be a dolomitic limestone. Well, on that triangle there, it looks like 15 on that. I take the 15 over here, it still comes to about 15. So if my game here is just simply say, just give me what is the porosity, it'll work for you in this mixture of lithologies. Here's an example then of how we can relate our log responses to what we see on cuttings. This is Miami County, and in fact we just looked at this section here. There's that gamma ray section. Limestones, Mississippian, above Cherokee sandstones and shales. So we see it's on limestone porosity units. The density is reading a little higher than the neutron here. That's picking up the quartz effect of this Cherokee sand. And as we go upwards, we're going into the sandstones and shales. And then we go up to this point and we say, whoa, what's going on? The density has taken off like crazy. It's heading to high porosity. The neutron is thundering off scale. Whenever you see that effect, you say, wash out. So we look over here and we say, well, the caliper doesn't see anything. And usually if you see a washout like that, it'll be something friable. A shale would be typical. So actually the gamma ray is dropping. It doesn't look like a shale at all. That is in fact a coal bed. So coals down there might have a density about 1.6 grams per cc. That is going to convert into so-called high porosity. Neutrons are going to read high too. Neutron sees an awful lot of hydrogen in those coals. And anybody who has any experience with coal bed methane says, oh yes, those coals have a lot of water. Keep pumping, pumping, pumping. And that's what the neutron's seeing there. Going down below, we go into these carbonates here. We've got limestones with a little bit of chert. Notice here that's what's being picked up on the cuttings log. Down here we've got interbedded, it's kind of interesting, tight limestones with more porous dolomitic horizons right there because the neutron's reading higher than the density. So, the information here, this represents ground truth if you like, but it is, these were bagged at 10-foot intervals. Whereas on the log at least, you're seeing something of resolution of between 2 and 3 feet. And of course the information, they complement one with one another. That's why if you look at some of the J.D. Davis logs, right at the top, J.D. Davis writes, E-log available, and he puts an exclamation mark to show his pleasure, because J.D. Davis and the rest of them, they like to have a log to look at so they could nail the tops. Conversely, it's sometimes helpful if you're in mysterious logs to say, anybody got some cuttings logs here so we can figure out some of the more mysterious lithologies. Nothing particularly mysterious about this, though. Notice also the coal came in rather shallower on the cuttings than we see here. And certainly that's the case in Canada, where usually they'll pick the depths of the coal based on the log, because remember that you have a lag time associated with the cuttings. And if you've got coals, which are much lighter, they'll tend to arrive earlier than they should. That's probably what's going on there. Here's an exotic, and I won't spend too long on it because it's not going to help us on reservoirs, but showing we don't always have to look at limestones, dolomite, sandstones. We look at logs of about any section. This is through the Nepawala group. We are looking at evaporites. So it kind of fries your brain, at least does mine. There's the scale and porosity, minus 10 to 30. And this is shaded because the neutron's going nuts. We think, whoa, what's going on, washouts or something? When we look at the caliper, and yeah, there's a washout there doing a nasty number there, but otherwise it seems more or less okay. And so we could focus, for example, on, yeah, maybe this guy right here. Very calm on the caliper, and yet the neutron is saying, I see 50% porosity. And we look at the curve out here. This is the density, and it would be about 2.35 grams. That is gypsum. So the element there is neutrons going nuts because it sees all the hydrogen in the water crystallization of gypsum. This bed here, that's a bizarre one, nice and clean, caliper's fine. Actually, it shows gypsum above, and then the zone below, the neutron is racing back on the first scale. The density is saying, gee, this stuff's heavy. That's an anhydrite bed. So calcium sulfate with no water, that's anhydrite. Calcium sulfate with a lot of water, that is gypsum. So of course this is of interest to geologists, love all this stuff, all different rock types, but just to emphasize even to an engineer that you can see all sorts of other stuff going on. And here's another section. This one is Elgin sandstone. Caliper looks basically okay. Here's the gamma ray. We have Ored limestone down here, Lecompton above. And here's the Elgin sandstone, kind of shaley in the middle. And pretty much tell it's a sandstone though, because look at the photoelectric curve, it's starting to push down towards that one point and it says, yeah, it's a sandstone, just rather shaley. And for geologists doing exploration, you could actually start to map out the characteristics of the shale above and below, so that if you were drilling and you missed the Elgin sandstone as a target, you could probably tell from the characteristics of this pro-delta shale where the nearest sandstone was. So opportunities for exploration just based on existing wells. And there we go, here's the Stone Corral. It shows up on all the seismic, that great ringing there, and you see, now I see why. Caliper, not very nice. Look at this, washouts here and here, another washout there, and you can see where the washouts are, that's where the neutron density are freaking out, because those are contact tools pressed up against the borehole wall, and they say, I see an awful lot of water, and you say, absolutely. It's not the issue so much of the borehole enlargement, because these tools are mounted on arms which try to maintain contact with the formation. It's just when you get a little notch like this, you're going to get suckered in by that stuff saying, oh, nope, that's not a culprit, that is just nasty washout. Otherwise, that kind of rumbles around okay. And so that's why we're getting reasonable responses. So we are in a shallow section since we're in the lower Permian, so those shales tend to be more friable anyway. And you can think of these washouts being caused, of course, by the circulation of the mud. It's like having underground weather. We have several centuries of intense rainfall, which now weathering this out is kind of an outcrop that you would see, say, on the roadside. Okay, nice low gamma ray, it's clean. The density has gone nuts because the density is that solid curve here and it's going off scale this way. It says, I'm so negative you can't believe it. It's coming back on that scale there. That is anhydrite at 2.98. The neutron, which had been having a grand old time in the shales, it sees lots of hydrogen, just slams down, bang, to zero. It says, I don't see any hydrogen in this anhydrite. The photoelectric curve, well, that's reading about 5. But don't be fooled, that's not a limestone. That's the same number as you get for anhydrite.